The life of the believer is to be distinctly marked with the miraculous, and that includes you. I believe that God wants to use your life to bring about miraculous results in the lives of others. And today I'm going to be going over 5 very practical keys for being used in the miraculous. So the title of this message today is How to Minister Miracles. Hello, I'm David Diga Hernandez, and you are watching Spirit Church. We're going to go right now with Stephen Moctezuma. He's going to lead you in some worship, and then we're going to come right back and get into this lesson where we're going to give you some applicable truths for your everyday life that will result in you seeing miracles all around you.
For thou, O Lord, art high above all the earth. O the earth, thou art exalted far above all gods. Sing again, for thou. Above all the earth, thou art exalted far above, oh God. Oh God. Just praise Him where you're at. Father, we exalt you, God. We exalt you, God. Yes, we do, God. Oh. We sing, I exalt. And I exalt thee. Father, we thank you, God, for joining with us tonight, God, for allowing us to worship you, Jesus. Father, we thank you, God.
I believe that God wants to use your life to bring about miraculous results in the lives of others. Now, I know I said that at the top of the program, but I really want to emphasize that to you today. And we're going to go through the scripture, and we're going to look at 5 practical keys that you can enact in your everyday life that will bring about miraculous results. I believe God wants to use you in healing. God wants to use you in the prophetic. God wants to use you to cast out devils. God wants to use you to bring financial breakthrough. I mean, there are so many miracles that God wants to do through your life. And I believe that if you'll just position yourself as the Word of God would teach us to do, to be in a place of obedience toward God, that miracles will follow you every single place that you go. And I truly believe that the life of the believer, at least of the average believer, if I could use that word, is to be filled with the supernatural power of the Holy Spirit. And God wants to bless you with that type of anointing. And He's, in fact, He's already given you that type of anointing. And maybe in your heart, you're saying, Lord, I want to be used in that way. I want to be used to see other people get breakthrough. And you don't want it so that you can glorify yourself. You don't want it so that men can praise you. But you want the power of God on your life so that as you preach the gospel, as you minister to people, that you can see the chains being broken off of their lives. I really do believe that this season we're now entering is going to be the greatest season that the church world has ever known. And God wants you to be a part of it. I truly believe that there's this shift that's taking place spiritually. And we're about to enter a new season of the church. I believe that an outpouring of the Holy Spirit is coming to America such as we've never seen before. Now, say what you will about the political climate, say what you will about the economic status of this world, say what you will about all of our standings in every other place of life, but I believe with all of my heart that Jesus Christ will reap the reward of His suffering. He's going to receive all for which He died. And because He died for those who are in America, it tells me that God is not done with America yet. And you are that righteous in the land that preserves this nation. And I truly believe with all my heart. In fact, I believe that the scripture even tells us that God's will shall be done in this nation in our time. So I want to talk to you about how to minister miracles. So number one, the first key to seeing miracles all around you, the first key to stepping out in the power of God and seeing these things take place is number one, preach the gospel. Now, I remember I was in, I believe it was Ensenada or TJ, Mexico for a three-night miracle service, and it was a powerful service. We actually, before we arrived at the event, we had done some advertising on television in Spanish, which was pretty cool. That was the first time I think we had done that. And we had let people know from all over the region, all over the churches had come, and the power of God was moving in these meetings. And there was one lady who came to the service, and she had been praying for her husband to give his heart to the Lord. And I don't know about you, but I have my prayer list of people that I've been praying for. But this woman had been praying for her husband for years. And if you've ever been in that situation where you're praying for a loved one to come to Christ, then you know that at times it can become discouraging, especially when you see them hardening their hearts or becoming more and more stubborn or even becoming irritated with you preaching the gospel to them. And so I can only imagine what this woman felt in that her spouse was rejecting the very Lord whom she loved and served. And she prayed for him, she preached to him, she served him, she loved him. She did all that she could to make sure that this man came to Christ. And she had told me that his heart was hard. In fact, I believe it was alcoholism that had bound his life. It was a spirit of alcoholism. And when I say that, I mean it's a demonic spirit that influences alcohol in somebody's life, even though man makes his own decision. That's a whole different topic. But she had been praying for him. And so he came to this meeting, and at first, from what I understood, this man was very skeptical of everything that was going on. He was very skeptical of the pastor. He was very skeptical of me. He was very skeptical of the people. I mean, this man was as skeptical as a man can get. And so he's sitting in the service, I guess, at the persuasion of his wife. He had been convinced to come to the service, and so he's there. Her prayers now, I believe, had at that point cultivated his heart to receive the gospel. I believe that this was the climax, that God, everything that she had prayed had led up to this moment. And I was happy to just be a part of it. So anyway, the service happened, the worship team played, and as usual, many of you have been to our services, the presence of the Holy Spirit just showed up in a tangible and a beautiful and a glorious way. It was one of those services where you felt like just a cloud of glory was resting on that building. And it really did feel that way. I mean, the atmosphere so filled that building that people began to tremble, people began to shake. Some people said they felt what seemed to be jolts of electricity surging up and down their being. People were being healed to my left, to my right. People were being healed outside of the building who were not even inside of the service. And we were just experiencing a wonderful move of the Holy Spirit. So this man, he's watching all of that is happening. And the way I had organized the service is I prayed for the sick. And then after I prayed for the sick, I presented the gospel. So we started with the miraculous. We showed people this is what Jesus does. Then I pulled out the word and began to declare the gospel truth, the gospel message, as it had been presented by the early church fathers, the apostles. And God anointed that word. And this little boy had come up to receive prayer. And this little boy, everyone kind of gasped when they heard his story, because it really was heartbreaking that I believe it was either his right eye or his left eye. It was one of his eyes that was blind. And he couldn't see out of that eye. And everybody was, when they heard this, their hearts broke. You could hear a gasp and a hush come over the room when he began to share his testimony of what he was believing for God to do in his body. And so I told the people, I said, God wants to heal this boy. And I believe God can heal this boy. I believe it's the will of God. I began to minister faith to the people through the word of God. And so I really did. I sensed the anointing come on me. And I just knew that I knew. I don't know if you've ever been there, but I just knew that I knew that I knew this boy was going to be healed. And so some people, as normally will be in a miracle service, some people were watching with skepticism. Some people were watching with interest. So there were some observers, but then there were those who were prayerfully participating in what God was doing on that platform. And we joined our faith together, all the believers, and we began to pray in the Holy Ghost. We spoke different languages, but when we began to pray in the Holy Ghost, we were praying one heavenly language. We began to pray in the Holy Ghost. We began to believe for God to do something for this kid. And I'm telling you, that little boy saw out of that eye. We covered the other eye, and he was able to tell us how many fingers people were holding up, what was able to happen. Little boy's crying, little boy's mother's crying. Now, what I didn't realize was that little boy was the son of that man who had come. And that man that night didn't just give his heart to the Lord, but when he came forward to give his heart to the Lord, he was sobbing, he was broken, he was ready to receive. When he saw what Jesus had done for his son, he surrendered his life to Christ. And so this is what the scripture says in Mark chapter 16, verse 20. And the disciples went everywhere and preached, and the Lord worked through them, confirming what they said by miraculous signs. Now, I must say, to qualify this lesson, that not every message accompanied by miracles is the gospel, but the gospel is always accompanied by miracles. I'll say that again. Not every message accompanied by miracles is the gospel, but the gospel is always accompanied by miracles. I mean, you read about those in Matthew chapter 7, I think it's verse 21, where they come up to the Lord and they said, Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name? Did we not do many good works? And he says, depart from me, you workers of lawlessness. I never even knew you. He didn't deny that they prophesied. He didn't deny that they cast out devils. He didn't deny that they did many wonderful works in his name. He just denied that he knew them. So there are those who work in miracles that don't necessarily make it into heaven. Now, this actually tells us of just how powerful the gospel message really is. In that anybody, even if whether or not their final destination is heaven or reward or punishment, whether or not Christ truly knows them, the gospel message is so powerful, it's so potent, it's so alive, and so filled with God's purpose and power, that when it is preached by even someone who doesn't know Christ, the gospel message results in miracles and signs and wonders. God endorses the gospel message with the miraculous. You'll notice that I've often said that God endorses his people with his presence. He endorses his faithful with his favor, but he endorses his message with his miracles. The people of God carry the presence of God, and there's no substitute for the presence of God upon a life. So only God's people carry his presence in such a way that it's distinctive. And God's faithful, these are those who consistently obey God and walk in his favor because of their obedience toward him. They're distinctly marked with the endorsement of heaven in the manifestation of favor. So faithfulness, the faithful are marked by favor. The people of God are marked by the presence of God. And the message of God is marked by the miracles of God. So here's the true statement that I often utter that sometimes offends people, but this is the truth. If you're not seeing miracles accompany the message that you preach, it's time to start preaching the gospel. If when you declare the message that you believe to be the gospel, and there's no backing for it, there's no transformation happening in the hearts and the souls of men, which, by the way, is the greatest miracle of salvation. So that's the number one way we know we're preaching the gospel, is if someone comes from repentance, they repent from their sins, turn to Christ, believe on the name of the Lord Jesus, are baptized in the Holy Spirit, receive the Spirit of God, and become his child. That's the result of the true gospel message. But if you're not seeing that, it's time to start preaching the gospel. If you're not seeing miracles back the message, then it's time to start preaching the gospel. Now, there are those who preach prosperity. There's no miracles that come when you preach prosperity. I've seen the difference. In fact, I remember I was in a church service, and this is nobody that I've ever had on the program. This is nobody that you know, and I'm not going to tell you who this minister was because I don't slander people. But there was a minister that I had gone to see, and this person was ministering in the prophetic. They're ministering words of knowledge. They're ministering God's Holy Spirit to the people. And as they're giving out words, I thought, this is wonderful. People are being touched. But not once in that entire service did I hear the name of Jesus. Not once in that entire service did I hear the gospel message being preached. Now, I know that not every service is an evangelistic service. I have some people get mad. They'll watch one or two YouTube videos and go, why are you not talking about this? I'm like, well, because right now I'm talking about this. You know, you can't always talk about everything that is truthful. Sometimes you have to focus, and this is what it's called. It's called being specific. It's called focusing. It's called teaching. And you hone in on one topic. Right now I'm talking about miracles. So I'm not really going to tell one how to be saved in this video. That's not what it's about. But that's not what I was requiring of the person in my own mind when I went to see them. My issue was that I didn't see one mention of Christ. I didn't hear any mention of God. I didn't hear any mention of how we need to serve. Nothing. The reason the people had gathered was to receive the miracles and the prophetic words, and they left. And the message, if it's lacking from the miraculous, that takes all the power out of it. So when you go to a service and all you see are miracles with no message, that's borderline witchcraft. That's incantation. That's New Ageism. That's psychic power. I've seen some wicked things from people who claim to be prophets of God, and they're not. And so I want to caution you that if you want to see miracles, and caution and encourage you, if you want to see miracles, you need to preach the gospel. That's the whole purpose of miracles. I mean, miracles fix a temporary situation in a supernatural way, but if that doesn't result in an eternal transformation, the miracle was of no use in the first place. Now, I understand not everybody responds to the gospel appropriately, but at least preach the gospel so that the message that's being preached that's accompanied by the miracles ultimately results in what we're ultimately after, which is the salvation of men. So number one, you need to preach the gospel. Number two, you need to spend time with Jesus. Now, there's no substitute for a prayer life. When I first started preaching, I studied the word, yes. I studied the scripture. I was reading books. I was giving myself to understanding, and I was asking the Lord for wisdom. In fact, when I was 11 years old, I said, Lord, I see this promise here in James. You said that if I ask you for wisdom, that you'll give me wisdom because I ask in faith. And so as an 11-year-old boy, I asked the Lord for wisdom, and I began to understand the scripture in ways I never could understand it before. So I was studying, I was reading, but let me tell you something. I wasn't that, I still today, I see areas I really need to work on in my presentation. I'm always working to improve my presentation as a preacher and teacher of the gospel, especially as an evangelist. I want to look for ways that I can evangelize in more effective manners. And so I would pray, I would ask the Lord to anoint it, I would study and give my best I could to God, and He would show up in those services in those first years of my ministry when I began to preach the gospel at the age of 13. But when I was 13, I wasn't this great preacher. I wasn't someone, I'll just be honest with you. I would get bored listening to my own sermons halfway, even though, because I would listen to them. I still do listen to them so I can listen for ways that I can improve how I would word something and so on. Or maybe even how I come across a certain way. I try to become effective. So even then when I attempted to do that, I was so bored with my own message, I would turn it off in the first 10 minutes. And I just really wasn't this great communicator. I wasn't some strong speaker. I didn't have this eloquent presentation. All I did was show up, preach a quick word. I still remember my first message was a 3-point message. It was on King David and his relationship with God. And I remember I preached that message, and I remember thinking, this is not as good as I imagined it in my head. You know, when I imagined preaching my first sermon, I imagined that it was going to be so, people were going to move to tears. They'd run to the altar, you know. But that's not what happened because of the message. People did come to the altar. People were moved to tears, but it had nothing to do with my presentation skills. It had everything to do with the presence of God. And the reason that the presence of God had anointed what I was doing was because I had consecrated myself, I had saturated myself, I buried myself in his presence, and I still to this day seek his face. And if you're not spending time with Jesus, you're not going to see miracles. I don't care what anybody says. If you're not praying, if you're not seeking the face of God, if you're not giving yourself to consecrated, devoted moments of prayer, you're not going to see miracles manifest in your life. Now, Acts chapter 4, verse 13 says this, "The members of the council were amazed when they saw the boldness of Peter and John, for they could see that they were ordinary men with no special training in the scriptures. They also recognized them as men who had been with Jesus." So a result of having been with Jesus was a tangible and a very real effect that took place in the lives of the apostles. Acts chapter 5, verse 15 says this, "As a result of the apostles' work, sick people were brought out into the streets on beds and mats so that Peter's shadow might fall across some of them as he went by." This is the healing presence of Jesus upon a life. You see, the Bible doesn't say that Peter's shadow healed the sick. A lot of people think it says that, and they'll go out and they'll kind of, which is fine, I'm not against it. They'll go out and they'll kind of walk across people, they'll go, "Look, my shadow heals." I've seen videos on YouTube. And that, if you want to do that, that's fine. If that's how God wants to work with your faith. But it wasn't Peter's shadow that was healing anybody. In fact, the Bible doesn't even say that it was that. It says that the people wanted Peter's shadow to heal them. So it was the people who thought that Peter's shadow healed. Now, what would cause people to think that a man's shadow could bring about a miraculous healing? It's not because his shadow healed people. It's because people who got around him were healed. Now, that's amazing. He didn't have to lay hands. He didn't have to pray purposefully, like, you know, as, and I use the word pray as in ministering to people as we're used to thinking in the traditional sense. You know, you lay hands, you say a little prayer as you're believing God for the healing. He didn't have to do that. He would just show up and miracles would happen all around him. I'll never forget when this first started happening, and what it did is it took the pressure off me, and it'll take the pressure off you. I felt so relieved because I would become so discouraged when I would see people come forward to receive healing. And some of the people who come to my meetings still to this day, I'm just being honest with you. I mean, it's not like nobody knows it. It's a fact. I mean, this is just the truth. Some people don't get healed. Now, I can do a whole different lesson on that, and there's a lot of theological thoughts that go into that and a lot of doctrines to go over. But for now, I'm just saying this so because it applies to what we're talking about. But when I realized that it had nothing to do with my efforts necessarily, that I was just a vessel through whom God used, but we have to make ourselves available still. Once I realized that, it took the pressure off, and I realized, Jesus, you're the healer. I'm not the healer. You're the healer. What about those who aren't healed? I have compassion for them. I pray that God would use me to greater levels so that I can see them healed. In fact, anytime I see someone not healed, I go home and that whole week is just more and more intense prayer. Lord, I want to, whatever it is, Lord, in me that's causing you not to be able to move through me in the way that this power should be flowing, I want you to help me. I want you to touch my life. I want you to show me. I want you to reveal yourself. And it causes me to seek God. And then the miraculous begins to increase in my life. Now, I will say this, there are levels to the miraculous. I know some people don't like that, especially some of this newer doctrine that's coming out. And the idea is that, well, you don't really have to do any growth. You have everything that you are right now. You're all in. And I understand that. We've talked about that. We've addressed that. But the truth is that there are levels to the miraculous power of God on your life because there are levels of spirituality. And the higher up you go in the levels of spirituality, the more the miraculous will increase. I'm giving you the truth because I want to see you increase in it. So you have the more time you spend with Jesus, the greater the healing power will be on your life, the greater the power for the miraculous will be on your life. So there's no replacement for this. And, you know, when it comes to believing God for those who, you realize, oh, God, they're not going to be healed, or maybe you've experienced that moment and made you feel uncomfortable, made them feel discouraged. Be encouraged to know that it's the healing presence of Jesus on your life. Your job is to pray for the sick. It's God's job to heal. And if something doesn't happen, it's not the problem. It's not with the word of God. I like to put the blame on myself because I don't put it on the people. I don't say, well, you didn't have enough faith. They walked up to receive prayer. That's an act of faith. So what I do is I take the responsibility as God's minister and I say, okay, Lord, whatever it is in me that needs to change, whatever it is in me that needs to transform, help me get there. And then also we can't forget about the sovereignty of God, which again, that's getting into a whole different lesson. But let's go to number three now. So number one, preach the gospel. Number two, spend time with Jesus. Number three, you got to live clean. James chapter 5, verse 15 says this. confess your sins to each other and pray for each other so that you may be healed. The earnest prayer of a righteous person has great power and produces wonderful results. I'm not talking about perfection, but the truth is that just as there are degrees of the miraculous, just as there are degrees of spirituality, so there are levels of holiness. Here's the truth, and just remember this principle as it applies all across the board to any of these concepts. If you can grow in something, it means there are levels to it. If there were no levels to holiness, then there would be no room for growth. Now, I understand that Christ is our righteousness. I understand that before God we're cleansed. But then there is still the process of sanctification that is happening in our lives. And the scripture is very clear, especially in Ephesians, more specifically Ephesians chapter 3, that we are to live a life that is worthy. The scripture says, walk worthy of the grace that you have received. And I'm paraphrasing. But the truth is that we need to grow in our holiness, and we need to grow in our righteousness, and we need to grow in our consecration, and we need to grow in our sanctification. And there are levels of cleanliness. There are levels of purity. There are levels of righteousness and holiness. And as you begin to grow in these levels of righteousness and holiness and purity and consecration and sanctification, so you will also grow in levels of miraculous power. The scripture says that the prayer of a righteous person has great power and produces wonderful results. Therefore, if someone is not righteous, there's not power on their prayer. We have to understand this. And again, I'm not talking about perfection. I'm saying that the more clean the vessel, the more the power of God can flow through. You know, if there's something that, say if I have a water hose and I want to water my yard, if the water's coming through there, but there's something blocking it, the issue is not with the source of the water. The issue is with the vessel. We need to clear out those areas in our life so that the power of God can flow purely, it can flow freely, it can flow more powerfully. We need to get rid of that blockage in our lives and live and walk in cleanliness, in holiness, in righteousness. And as you do, you will see that there is great power in purity. Another thought on this specific point, Psalm chapter 37, verse 23 says this, "The Lord directs the steps of the godly. He delights in every detail of their lives." So God directs the godly. He doesn't direct the ungodly per se, except for the times that he directs them to saving power and the saving knowledge of Christ. Just as, you know, Saul of Tarsus, when he was on his way to persecute the church, God directed him. He rerouted him. But that's an occurrence of salvation, God calling one to repent. But beyond the call to repentance, beyond the call to fulfill the call of God through repentance and turning to Christ, beyond that, God does not direct the righteous, except for how he preaches the gospel through those around them, like you or I preach the gospel to our unsaved friends. But still, that categorically speaking has only to do with their redirection towards salvation. But other than that, God does not direct the steps of the ungodly. In fact, that's why the scripture says the blind fall into the pit, because God's not there to guide them. They cannot see where they're going. Now, if you're godly and he directs your steps and delights in every detail of your life, then you're going to see more open doors. The truth is that obedience puts you in the will of God. And the will of God is the only place that you'll find the opening of divine doors. People ask me, how are you seeing all this favor? And anyone who looks at this ministry from the outside looking in, and I'm not saying this to brag, I'm saying this because all glory belongs to God. He took someone who said, "Lord, I don't have much, but whatever you want to use, take it. And if God can use me, trust me, he can use you." But God took my life, and people see there's favor. And I acknowledge that humbly. I'm not saying that again to brag, but I do acknowledge there's favor on my life. But I'm telling you, there's no secret. There's no special. It's not because I'm talented. It's not because I'm gifted. It's very, very simple. All I do is try to hear God my absolute best and try to obey God with my absolute best. It's just as simple as that. And if you'll do those two things, if you'll try to hear God and you'll give yourself to seek his face, and you'll lend him your ear. We understand that there's power in prayer. We understand we're getting lessons on how to pray. I did a lesson on how to spend more time in prayer. I did a lesson on keys to prayer. But we often fail to understand why it is so important to pray. I mean, my goodness, I should do one on that. But the truth is that when you pray, it puts you in alignment with God. When you obey, it puts you in alignment with God. And because of that purity, because of that righteousness, you're able to hear God more clearly. Because of that righteousness, you're positioned in the places that you should be. King David, when he fell into sin with Bathsheba, the scripture says that this was during the time that kings go out to war. David was not in the place that he was supposed to be. And time again, you'll notice that calamity comes, that problems come, that temptation is given into, because we put ourselves in places that we are not supposed to be. And if you're not in places that you're supposed to be, you won't see the favor of God. How are you supposed to walk through an open door if you're not standing in front of it? Obedience puts you in front of the open door. Now, some doors are locked, but faith turns the knob and it checks to see which ones God has open. But how are you supposed to stand in front of an open door? How are you supposed to walk through it if you won't even be near it? So obedience brings about righteousness and holiness. And because of that, I should qualify that, because I don't necessarily believe that we work out our righteousness by our acts, but I truly do believe that because of what Christ has done in us, that righteousness should result. Nonetheless, as we obey God, as we work to live more righteously, as we, in fact, I just read it today. I hope I can find it. It's not in my notes. I underlined it earlier. Okay, yes. Okay, so this is from Romans chapter 2, verse 6. He will judge everyone according to what they have done. He will give eternal life to those who keep on doing good, seeking after the glory and the honor of immortality that God offers. So it's talking about a continuation, a persistent and intentional pursuit of holiness and righteousness in our lives. So as believers, even though we've already been justified, we still have to work very carefully with God, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling, the scripture says, because that is the process of sanctification. And there is power in purity. The greater the purity, the greater the power. Number four, build faith. When you're ministering to people, you have to build their faith. This is what the scripture says in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 9. The same Spirit gives great faith to another. To someone else, the one Spirit gives the gift of healing. So this context is talking about the gift of healing and the gift of faith. And this is 1 Corinthians chapter 12. This is the chapter on the gifts of the Holy Spirit. Now, some believe that the gift of faith has to do with our own faith, but that's not the truth. Because the reality is that these gifts, the scripture says, are for others. So there's the measure of faith, and then there is the gift of faith. The measure of faith is personal. The measure of faith is what God has given you so that you can see results in your own life of what God wants to do. But the gift of faith, I believe, is the ability to raise people's faith to a different level. Jesus had this faith. I mean, the scripture also said, Romans chapter 10, verse 17. Now, this is somewhat of a misused scripture, but I'm going to read it anyway, and then I'll qualify it. Romans chapter 10, verse 17. So faith comes by hearing, or faith comes from hearing. That is, hearing the good news about Christ. Now, that contextually is talking about the gospel message of Christ. But it's saying that they can't believe the gospel unless they hear it. In the same sense, whatever the promises of God have to do with the need of a person, they cannot have the faith to receive based upon those promises according to their need unless they hear what the word has to say about their need. So they won't know God offers it, and they won't have the faith to receive it until they hear the promise where God promises what he wants to give them. So faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Now, that was talking about the gospel, faith to believe the gospel. But faith to be healed comes by hearing about the message of healing. Faith to receive a miracle comes about from hearing just how powerful God is. So as your faith expands, you're able to receive greater and greater things. This is why God processes you gradually. So he'll put you in a situation, and in that situation, you may feel you cannot handle it, but you grow your faith a little more there. And then you face another situation, and it seems just as difficult as the last season. Here's the truth. The issues that you're facing in this season, you may think it's just as bad as last season, but the truth is that the weight you're carrying in this season is heavier than what you carried in last season. You just don't recognize it because you're stronger. And God wants to take you through this process, and I'm not saying we're to have a joyless existence in the Christian life. On the contrary, we have joy despite what we go through. But these type of trials, these type of troubles, they produce faith within us, and in concordance with that, we also have a gift of faith developed in us that when we speak to other people, we can build their faith. This is part of ministering miracles to people. You've got to position them to receive. The scripture talks about many times that Jesus, when he healed someone, just take the healing for example, when Jesus healed someone, he would say, your what has made you whole? That's right, your faith has made you whole. So it is by faith that we receive many things. So our goal is to build the faith of people so that they can receive the miraculous that God wants to give them. So this gift of faith, you're basically an atmosphere of faith. You're basically, everywhere you go, when you talk, whatever comes out of your mouth should be faith building. I know people like this. There's a pastor friend of mine who I absolutely love. His name is Phil Muncy. If you ever get to connect with his ministry, just an absolutely amazing man of God. He is probably the most encouraging person I have ever met in my entire life. This guy, when he comes in the room, I've watched him. I've traveled locally with him. I've driven him around sometimes. I like to serve men of God like that and just kind of glean from them. So I would be driving him around sometimes. I'd go with him to TBN, be back there, watch him talk to the guest. And you know, this guy, I would just watch him, and he's very intentional about boosting faith in other people. And he does so by encouraging, he does so by speaking the word, he does so by declaring things such as where people are there, maybe they're talking, I've seen some pastors talk in discouragement, oh well, we might lose the building. He'll say, no, God's gonna provide, and even if you lose that building, God's got another building. And I've seen that gift of faith in action, and getting around him, my faith gets stirred. There are plenty of people who I get around. I mean, I can name them all day. I mean, you guys know Ken Brown. You guys know Prophet Rob. Some of you know my friend Daniel Galeana, who great ministry. If you haven't checked him out, you should check him out. Michael Koulianos, Daniel Park. I mean, all these guys are on YouTube. I really recommend them all. But I when I get around these guys and when I hear them, when I talk to them, their faith just, it rubs off on me, and my faith in turn rubs off on them, and we stir each other to faith. That is the gift of faith in operation. So when you're ministering miracles to people, you have to build faith. You have to build an atmosphere that is cultivated with the word of God, that's saturated with faith, so that you get them ready to receive. So again, number one, preach the gospel. Number two, spend time with Jesus. Number three, live clean. Number four, build faith. Number five, act. Now, I know I always read this scripture, but let's read it again. Mark chapter 16, verse 15 through 17. And then he told them, go into all the world and preach the good news to everyone. Anyone who believes and is baptized will be saved, but anyone who refuses to believe will be condemned. Verse 17, these miraculous signs will accompany those who believe. They will cast out demons in my name, and they will speak in new languages. And then the scripture also goes on to say, they'll lay hands on the sick, verse 18, and they shall recover. We all know that one. But the truth is, a lot of people think that this is Jesus telling the apostles they're going to move out in this. No, he says, "These go and preach, and whoever believes will be saved. Whoever doesn't believe is condemned. But the ones who believe what you say, not the apostles, he says, the ones who believe, those ones are going to move out in the miraculous. Now, I don't believe that the power of the Holy Spirit is limited to just these things. On the contrary, we see all throughout the New Testament, especially in the writings of Paul, we see the concept of many acts of the miraculous that are to be functioning in our lives. But the truth is that none of this is going to happen unless you act. We say, well, I'm waiting to be led. No, how can you wait to be led when Jesus already commanded it? We say, God, show me. He did. It's in the word. He said, go preach the gospel. Well, I don't know if I'm qualified. Are you saved? Do you believe? You're the one he'll use then. You say, well, I want to become more pure. Well, good. While you're on the process of sanctification, let God use you where you're at right here, right now. Well, I'm not quite there yet. Yes, you are. You can minister to someone. You can help someone. You can help someone receive a miracle today. It's funny. We're always praying, Lord, bless me. Lord, help me. We look at our needs. We lay hands on our bills. We pray for our checks to come in. We pray for our sickness. We pray for our discouragement, our trial. And we're saying, God, send someone. Send help. And I think that if we would just learn to be the miracle in other people's lives for which we are praying in our own lives, that God himself would move on our behalf. That if we would stop looking at our own needs and start looking at other people's needs, we basically step under the fountain of God's provision and power, and we experience the miraculous in our own lives when we selflessly minister it to others. So you have to act. Number five, you have to act. Now, I'm not saying go and rip people out of wheelchairs. You know, you got to be very wise with how you do this. And you have to carry the gospel with class, and you have to have a heavenly elegance about you. You are a minister and ambassador of heaven. I don't believe the Holy Spirit makes you silly or senseless. I've seen people. Now, I've had some people in my services, they get drunk in the Holy Spirit. Now, if God does that, great. I'm not going to try to incite that. I don't try to incite anything. But I'm always very careful with how I present the Holy Spirit. I want to make sure it's done so in a very classy manner. But signs of the Holy Spirit moving is not when you get senseless and silly. Signs of the Holy Spirit moving is when the glory of God shows up and when people become transformed. And I'm telling you, God wants to use your life just like that. Now, I want to pray with you, because I know you're stirred, not because I'm preaching, because the word of God is being spoken. The word of God, when it's preached, it stirs something. And the scripture says that he is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all we could ask or think. God wants to do that, not just in your life, but he wants to use you as a vessel, as a conduit, as a catalyst for the miraculous in the lives of those around you. You are a walking heavenly atmosphere. You are the temple of the Holy Spirit. And God wants to use your life wherever you may be at. You may be saying, I'm disqualified because of this. I'm disqualified because of that. No, God doesn't count you out, and neither should you count yourself out. Your greatest qualification for ministry is the Holy Spirit within you. It's not about how capable you are. It's not about how gifted you are. It's about how surrendered you are. Now, let's believe that God would continue and begin to use you in the miraculous. Come on, join your faith with my Father in the precious name of the one whom I serve, the name of Jesus. I agree with that one watching. Man, I believe God's touching you right now. God's doing something special. I agree with that one watching, Lord. And I pray, Father, that your anointing, your power would begin to flow through my hands and touch that one watching, believing in faith. Lord, we thank you for your anointing. We thank you for your grace. We thank you for your love. We thank you for your gospel. So, Lord, I pray that as your word was preached here today, that you would endue us with power afresh and that you would cause us to be stirred to believe for the miraculous. Lord, no matter how great the trial, no matter how big the need in front of us, Lord, that we would step out boldly in faith and declare that God is able. And I pray, Father, your power rest on them in the matchless name of Jesus. And I want you to say it out loud, say it boldly. If you agree, amen. That's right. I truly do believe. I'm excited for you because I truly do believe God wants to begin to use you in this now. Go out now. Go out now and begin to act because God has anointed you. Now I want to welcome the new members of Spirit Church. We are just approaching, very quickly approaching, 200 members of Spirit Church. I'm so excited about that. And I'm glad you're joining. Let me tell you something. When you join Spirit Church, you are joining a body of believers united from all around the world. We get together here. This is our Spirit Church weekly. I post a video weekly, a teaching. Not only that, when you join Spirit Church, you're going to get a weekly email. And in that email, you're going to be able to respond, get prayer. You're going to be able to ask questions. You're going to be able to suggest topics. You're going to see the lesson for every week. And the best thing about it is you can attend weekly on your own schedule. Now, I believe in getting planted in a church physically where there are people. But I know there are some people that are different seasons of life. Maybe you've been hurt by church and you're looking for somewhere to attend. Maybe this could be your place for now. And I look at Spirit Church as a nice transitional place for people to move from an online church into a local church, and we could even help plug you into local churches. We're connected with over 300 churches all around the U.S. and over 2,500 churches all around the world, and we can suggest a Holy Spirit-filled, Bible-believing church just for you and your family that I know will bless you. There's no such thing as the perfect church, so you know you got to get in, plugged in somewhere. Now, some of you do count this as your church, and we do gather now and then. We do events, and we are planning to put a physical location soon. So if this is your church, if you're a member of Spirit Church, now is the time to sow your tithes and offering. Even if you're not a member of Spirit Church, you enjoy this teaching. We put this out for everybody to see so they can receive impartation, whether or not they consider themselves a member of Spirit Church. We're all part of the body of Christ, right? But if you're blessed by this ministry, whether that's through Encounter TV, which is our television program, you'll notice there's several different playlists on our channel. I recommend you go check them out here. If you're not watching this on YouTube, or you're watching this on the app or the website, go to youtube.com/EncounterTV. You're going to get a lot of great stuff there. But, you know, you'll notice we have Encounter TV. That's the half-hour program. That airs on actual television, satellite and cable and antenna all over the world. And then there's Spirit Church, which is kind of like our online program. And then you'll see all these other different types of programs that we put out. Stephen Moctezuma has a playlist on here. If you want to get into some worship, I do prayers. If you just want some quick prayer, or maybe you want to send a prayer to someone, that's on here too. Lots of great things on this channel. Don't forget to subscribe to Encounter TV. But again, you're blessed by our ministry. You go to our miracle services. You watch us on television. Or maybe, you know, you're receiving ministry through any other way. Now is the time to sow. I'm telling you, there is an increase coming on this ministry, and we're seeing it now. We're beginning to see you guys starting to respond. And I'm telling you, Thank you. If you're sowing into this ministry, it doesn't go to me. It goes to the ministry. I take a portion for myself, but that's through salary. I'm taxed on it. It's capped. It's not like I'm just counting the dough back there. I promise you, we're using this for the gospel. And you can sow in today. Sow today. Don't say, oh, maybe next week, because then you'll forget. And the truth is, when we say, I'll do it later, we're actually giving ourselves more time because we really don't want to do it. But I'm going to challenge you now. You're blessed by this ministry. You're blessed by the teaching. Do a one-time gift of $5, $10, $30. Maybe you can do that right now. Maybe you can do a one-time gift of $100, $500. Maybe God spoke to you even to do $1,000. That was in your heart. You're a little hesitant. Just do it. God's going to take care of you. If God told you to do it, do it. And maybe you can do a monthly gift of $5, $10, or even $30 a month. Either way, all the support, both one time and monthly, helps to keep the gospel going all around the world through this ministry, through international events, worldwide television, and global discipleship ministry. Well, I sure do love you. I'm praying for you. And I just want to encourage you again today after the message. Just go out and believe God to use your life in the miraculous. That's it for this edition of Spirit Church. Until next time, remember, nothing is impossible with God.
After the debt of sin, justice is the one who demands the pay.
And it is heaven's agenda that you fulfill what God has placed in you. God has
Jesus.